Hello, everyone. Welcome to December Delights, Guernica's winter book launch. My name is Anna, and I'm the publicist here at Guernica. Today, we're excited to present 8 brand new titles to you by our extremely talented authors and editors. Let's give them a hand. Canticles I, 2016 by George Elliott Clarke. The Examine Life by Luciano Iacobelli. Mankind and Other Stories of Women by Marianne Ackerman. Tidal Fury by Brenda Clews. Max's Folly by Bill Turpin. Maniac Drifter by Laura Marello. And Clarke, Blaise, Essays on His Works, and Clarke, Blaise, The Interviews, edited by J.R. Tim Struthers. We're extremely lucky today because Clarke, Blaise himself is here with us at the front, and he'll be saying a few words as well. So a big welcome to Clarke. We're so happy you could make it out. Two of our authors, Laura Marello and Marianne Ackerman, couldn't make it to their launch today, but we'll still be speaking about their books. Laura Marello actually did a short reading for you guys and recorded it on video, so we'll be playing that as well. And we're very pleased to have John Goddard, a Toronto author and former Toronto Star reporter, here to read from Marianne's collection. We're also very lucky because Brenda Clews, who is not only one of our great poets, but also a video wizard, is recording the whole launch for us today. So we'll make sure that it's available on our social media sites and on YouTube in the next few days. Our intern Alex will introduce our first book.
Hi, everyone. So our first title today is by author Laura Marello, who unfortunately could not join us today. Marello is the author of 7 novels, 2 collections of stories, a collection of poems, 2 memoirs, and a screenplay. She has been awarded a National Endowment for the Arts grant, a Wallace E. Stegner Fellowship at Stanford University, and a Fine Arts Work Center Provincetown Fellowship, as well as Vogelstein and Deming grants and writer's residences at McDowell Colony, Yaddo, Malay Colony, and Metalvo Center for the Arts. Her novel, Claiming Kin, was shortlisted for the Penn Bingham Award and for the Patterson Award. She is currently a professor of English at Lynchburg College. Set in Provincetown in the 1980s, her latest novel, Maniac Drifter, is about Kate, who has amnesia about all her sexual experiences. She tries to help her friend, Harper Martin, when he is in trouble as a result of smuggling pre-Columbian art objects into the United States from Nicaragua. Provincetown rallies to help absolve him of the charges. As the plot unravels, Kate learns to forgive, and Provincetown's desperate factions come together as a community to help one of its members. This is a comic literary novel about friendship, trust, art, community, and forgiveness. We will now show a short video of Laura Marello reading from Maniac Drifter.
And I'm going to read to you from Maniac Drifter. The sun was too bright for me. Everything around me, the railing, the planks beneath my feet, the sky, gets his arm next to mine, appear raw and overexposed. I looked down into the water and tried to forget myself. The glare was almost blinding, and soon that was all I could see, a bright, luminescent silver that slid and shifted rhythmically with the motions of the water, lulling me, tempting me into abandonment, so that when the upheaval came, just the slightest lifting up, the gentlest pressure on my arms and legs, then the soft, quick falling. It was almost imperceptible, and I lay floating naturally in the water, just as calm and absent as I had been looking down into it, the happy silver glare all around me, the gentle lapping about my ears, like contented murmurs, a purr of oblivion. If I had thought about anything then, lying in the current with no notion of danger or death, I would have known that this was oblivion, and oblivion was the peace and satisfaction, the rest from longing and desire, the surfeit I had been seeking all along and had never found until that moment. The shouting brought me back to consciousness. I looked up and saw the boat at a distance, the tiny people at the railing in their bright colored shirts. waving and shouting killer whale, throwing ropes and life preservers into the water. They looked precious, the way Provincetown looked when the boat had drawn away from shore. I looked up at the sun. I did not want this, the noise, the commotion, the running and shouting. I wanted to go away again into that peaceful place the glare had sent me, where I was finally satisfied. I stared at the sun for a while and felt as if I were losing myself again, going under, back into oblivion. I even felt that gentle lifting as if something good intentioned was displacing me. This almost convinced me I would return to that place, but the shrieks from the boat grew even louder. I opened my eyes just as I felt my head break the surface of the water. I blew the water out of my mouth by instinct and looked around. They were throwing a small life raft into the water. I could see Angelo at the rail holding the megaphone. "Kate," he shouted, "don't be afraid. The whale won't hurt you. It's trying to keep you afloat." I peered down into the water. My arms and legs were now too numb from the cold to actually feel, and it gave me an odd sensation to see them treading water when I could not sense the swoosh of the currents. On my left, out of my side vision, I caught a swatch of white pass by and then a dark body of black follow on top of it. Even this close in the water, the animal seemed too small to be a whale, too nimble and sprightly, as if it had some playful mischief in mind. I watched it circle, surface, breach, and dive again, and tried to follow its course, underneath and around me. It was much too small and sleek to be a whale, I decided, and it had that bright white patch underneath its head. It looked more like a dolphin. "Kate," Angelo shouted again, "it's the orca that was hanging around the harbor a few weeks ago. It will let you swim with it. Grab hold of the fin. Put your hand on the fin." It seemed like the simplest thing in the world to do, grab onto the fin. I only had to reach out my hand and catch hold of it. The animal would do the rest. I looked around at the water, the bright sun, at my own disembodied limbs below, treading to keep me afloat, and I wondered at how arbitrary it all was. I was not sure I wanted to go back, but if I grabbed hold of its fin, the dolphin would take me. And if I did not, the dolphin would just go for a swim. Expend its mischief. While I tried to make up my mind, the dolphin circled and the tourist yelled from the boat, and Getz climbed down a ladder into the raft to come after me. In the end, it was not really a decision. They weren't going to allow me my oblivion. All I did was reach out my hand, and the dolphin took me. Thank you.
Next up, we have John Goddard reading from Mankind and Other Stories of Women. Longtime Montrealer and frequently produced playwright Marianne Ackerman was born in Belleville, Ontario. She has an MA in drama from the University of Toronto and studied French at the Sorbonne. Her three published novels include the bestseller Jump and her new comedy Triplex Nervosa, the first of a trilogy called Mile End Days and Nights, premiered at the Centaur Theatre in 2015. Mankind and Other Stories of Women is Ackerman's second collection of short stories with Guernica, and it puts the focus on women. They are sent into selfhood and the beauty and carnage of their journey. Literary Montreal is the setting of two stories spun around an alpha poser, George, picking up from the gothic shadows of Albert Fine, which is Marianne's first collection with Guernica. In Holy Fools, Ackerman follows the lives of an Ontario farm family marked by a bloody incident they struggle to understand. Four interlocking stories plumb the secrets of one man's sister, ex-wife, friend, and mother. Sardonic and often funny, these tales follow the byways of aspiration and self-deception, casting light on all. Elise Moser, author of Because I Have Loved and Hidden It, described the book like this. A pleasure to read. These clear-eyed stories of women's lives are told with no romantic haze. Intelligent, beautifully crafted, spiked with humor. And we're very happy to welcome John Goddard to read for Mankind.
I love this event, a room full of writers. I've been here a couple of times. Let me just add a little bit about the profile of Marianne. You can get a good idea right from the cover of this book, Mankind and Other Stories About Women. and it shows a naked man with his arms broken off. I don't think that's her total impression of men, but you can get some idea of, well, I won't give the whole book away. As Anna said, the stories are quite varied in style and subject matter. I have selected the final story. It's called Rashmi. That's a name of a woman. The narrator is unnamed, but an anthropologist living in Montreal. And the story opens with a conference, academic conference in Mumbai, India. And the narrator's emotions are kind of going up and down, some troubles in her life. But the conference is very successful. She's won a prize, she's got a publishing contract, and she decides to stay on for a few days and see a bit of the city. This is where I'm going to pick up. That first day and night, alone in my hotel room watching television, felt much like the dark time after my husband's death. I forced myself to get a plan. As an anthropologist, I've developed a preference for social interactions, which may be why I put myself in the hands of an independent guide who was also the sister of the guy who ran the newsstand near the hotel, because I couldn't bear to do anything as simple as jump on an air-conditioned bus. Her name was Rashmi. She was my age. Her rates were reasonable, her knowledge of the city profound, eccentric, sadly critical, but loving. Through Rashmi's eyes, the clash of poverty and wild luxury, the speed, smells, colors, the noise, the relentless din of car horns, roaring motors, screeching crows, hawkers, were all part of the elaborate work of theater. And weren't we envious, those of us born on the outside, grateful for a glimpse into this older, wiser, magical drama of existence? I'm just going to skip over a bit. So our narrator has a good time in Mumbai, seeing the city with Rashmi. And at some point along the way, she says to Rashmi, if you're ever in Montreal, come and see me. So the narrator is sitting in a lecture hall one day and gets a text saying, I guess Rashmi's some problems in her life have developed. And she says, can I come and see you now? And the narrator says, I love spontaneity. Sure, you can come. And she does. The moment she unzipped her suitcase at the head of the on the bed of my spare room is one I won't forget. A cloud of Indian smells escaped. I will cook for you, she declared, taking out a huge plastic bag full of colorful pouches, every shade from the hotter spectrum of spices. Red, orange, brown, yellow, gold, sand, plus whole cardamom pods and nut-sized peppercorns. My apartment soon filled with kitchen smells. She worked as if on a mission. Tentatively at first, a mild curry, which I praised. After that, she let herself go, rummaged through my cupboards of pots and utensils, making lists of things she needed from the Indian stores along Jean Talon Boulevard. I've never spent so much money on out-of-season tomatoes, but then I'd never imagine they could taste like they tasted under Rashmi's touch. I'm skipping over a couple of paragraphs as I go, just to just to tighten it up. In Mumbai, she had taken me to a Jain temple, explained that the sterner religion, the sterner followers avoid all root vegetables because microbes are damaged when they're yanked from the earth. So strict is their belief in nonviolence toward living things. She wasn't a Jain, but her respect for their codes was strong. When she presented me with a sumptuous mutton dish, I sensed disgust and insisted she take meat off the menu. From then on, we ate vegetables of many colors and textures. Scads of chickpeas, lentils, nuts, beans, unnamed grains, and peppers red, green, yellow, and very hot, always swimming in pungent sauce, sometimes smothered in yogurt to quell the fire. But I got used to it. I looked forward to meals, refused to spoil my appetite by nibbling on empty calories. I lost weight. I've never felt cleaner, more energetic, or happier than during the months Rashmi cooked for me. Like most women, I sometimes wondered what it'd be like to have a wife. Someone to do what I had done for my husband, meaning everything that had nothing to do with his work and organizing distractions so that he could be better at his work. My fantasy wife would be like Rashmi, intelligent, quiet, industrious, cheerful, and mysterious. The story goes on, but I'm going to leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Next up, we have J.R. Tim Struthers and Clarke Blaise, who will be presenting two books, one book of essays on the work of Clarke Blaise, and also a book of interviews, 18 interviews, which compiles conversations that Clarke Blaise had with a variety of authors and readers, including Brian Bartlett, Catherine Bush, Alexander MacLeod, and John Metcalf, Barry Cameron, Jeff Hancock, Catherine Sheldrick Ross, and J.R. Tim Struthers himself. Highly respected nationally and internationally by scholars and creative writers for his work as a small press publisher, editor, literary critic, interviewer, and bibliographer J.R. Tim Struthers has edited some 25 volumes of theory, critical essays, autobiography, fiction, and poetry, including works in honor of or by such important Canadian writers as Clarke Blaise, George Eliot, Jack Hodgins, Hugh Hood, John Metcalf, Alice Munro, and James Rennie. Tim is the author of the first two scholarly articles worldwide on Alice Munro and has been described by W.J. Keith as probably the best literary interviewer in Canada. Together with John Metcalf, he co-edited Clarke Blaise's selected essays. A very enthusiastic professor of English, Tim has devoted more than 30 years of full-time service to the University of Guelph, and he lives in Guelph with his bride of 40 years, poet and scholar Marianne Micros, who is actually here with us today as well. And Canadian author Clarke Blaise is a graduate of the Iowa Writers' Workshop at the University of Iowa, and he was the director of the International Writing Program there. In 2009, he was made an officer of the Order of Canada and was the founder of the postgraduate program in creative writing at Concordia University. His body of work of over 20 books includes the internationally acclaimed The Meager Tarmac, which was longlisted for the Scotiabank Giller Prize, Lunar Attractions, winner of the Books in Canada Long Novel Award, Montreal Stories, and Man and His World. He is married to acclaimed Indian-American author Bharati Mukherjee. And we also have one of the contributors as well, is that right, Tim, who will be saying a few words?
The artist,
Ron Shuebrook. Okay, perfect. Well, welcome. We invite you up.
Drinkers in your time. I'm a two-fisted editor. At one point in his career, Robert Croce gave an address in Italy that he later collected in his first book of essays, The Lovely Treachery of Words. In that essay, which was called Learning the Hero from Northrop Frye, Croce recalled how, as a graduate student, in the very year that Frye published his opus, Anatomy of Criticism, Croce had given a seminar presentation in graduate school on that book. And in his talk in Italy, Croce reflected that very possibly he'd been giving a version of that same seminar presentation every time he spoke in the decades that followed. Well, that got me thinking. That got me thinking back to a time in the spring of 1966, over 50 years ago, a about 2 or 3 months before Clarke moved to Montreal, when I was in grade 11 and gave a speech on the topic of motivation. The topic had been suggested to me by my parents. Truth be told, the damn speech was probably written by my parents. But thinking about Croce's comment made me realize that as much as I feel that it has been my great blessing to teach and edit works by and edit works in honor of that group, including Clarke, that I call the Canadian Renaissance, as much as that has been my privilege to teach the writing of these people and to interview them and celebrate their work through various publications that I've had the pleasure of doing, that it occurs to me that maybe as a teacher and maybe also in the editorial work that I've been doing, that actually it's had more to do with motivation. And so, like, you know, Robert Croce, I've been, you know, saying the same thing in this case for 50 years, and have probably now made millions from the University of Guelph doing exactly that, which is pretty good. If I were to redefine the topic at this point, I think that what I would want to talk about would be not so much motivation, but the sources of inspiration that feed whatever sense of motivation you have yourself and whatever sense of motivation that you are able to transmit to others. The sort of motivation, the sources of inspiration that feed that motivation, that enable the commitment that we bring to do the work that we all do. Foremost amongst my sources of inspiration, of course, is my bride of 40 years, Marianne Micros, and Guernica author, just to let you know how sharp a guy I am, okay? You know? Foremost, and of course the other members of our family, our two daughters and four grandchildren, who may all grow up to become Guernica writers too. Michael, having mentioned to me last night that his father lived to age 95 and his mother to age 97, and that he's hoping that he's got those genes. So, you know, so he figures he's got the same genes, and so that this augurs well for the future decades of Guernica, I must say. There are so many other sources of inspiration. As a teacher, I say that I believe that I receive far more than I give. I believe the same about my editorial work. There is, of course, the subject that you choose for work that you're doing. In this case, Clarke Blaise. As a writer, for the intricacy yet clarity and the extraordinary power of his writing, Clarke means the world to me. And as a man, for his valor and his generosity and his untold kindnesses to so many, he means even more. There are others whom we would both thank, including the dedicatee of these two extraordinary extraordinarily smart-looking volumes. And still, after however many proofreadings, I will attest, exciting to read books. The dedicatee of those two books, Clarke's fellow Montreal storyteller, John Metcalf, who, upon receiving the essay collection, read the entire book and paid one of possibly the greatest compliment that John has ever paid to a book prepared by, you know, a university teacher, an academic, in which he said that he read the whole book and there wasn't a single essay in it that made him want to throw the book across the room. Now that's praise from a certain quarter, I will tell you. He also asked me to relay two other points. One, his heartfelt commendation to Guernica and to Michael Mirolla for supporting Canadian writing in the way that Guernica does, and in particular through its Canadian Writer series, and specifically here, these two volumes in honor of Clarke. He also wanted me to add that he considers Clarke to be one of the great writers. And he didn't add today or of our times. What he said was he considers Clarke Blaise to be one of the great writers in the entire history of Canadian writing. And about those writers whom John praises, I will say he is never wrong. A very special part for me in terms of doing both these books has been the opportunity to introduce Clarke's work to students of mine of different decades. Sherry Talenko, who did an interview with Clarke on I Had a Father, Graham Northcote, who wrote an essay on Hawthorne and Blaise, Andrew McCaig, wrote an essay on border crossing in Clarke's work, and Dalbir Singh, who wrote an essay on the sorrow and the terror. In addition, I've been able to persuade a number of colleagues of mine, both from my days at Western, Catherine Sheldrick Ross, who has an interview and an essay in the two books. Of her, I always say, when I grow up, I want to be Catherine Ross. And my old friend, William Butt, from Western, my days at Western. Then from Guelph, fiction writer and critic Sandy Sabatini, fiction writer and critic Stephen Hennigan, and critic Sandra Singer. To be able to bring these people together has been extremely special to me. And as I say, from that kind of conversation, whether it was across tabletops such as those figured in the drawings by Ron Shuebrook, Site of Discourse number one, Site of Discourse number two, that appear on the front covers of the two books, whether it's across actual tabletops such as the ones that you're sitting at right now or through other means, those kinds of conversations have inspired, motivated, and me, and strengthened my sense of commitment in ways that I can never properly acknowledge. Publisher Michael Mirolla is such a wonderfully considerate man, He is also extremely astute and attends to details. He found the one mistake in the essays book that I made, but I said, consider it. He also pointed it out to me so that I didn't have to go through the entire book and try to find it, because it was one of those mistakes. It was a word like silt versus slit that has no red underlining under it, so you don't know it's a mistake, but he caught it. And, you know, and that's a good publisher has your back. You know, boy. Finally, in terms of conversations over tabletops, specifically in Guelph, my longtime friend, Ron Shuebrook, the artist Ron Shuebrook, also former president of OCAD, without whose energy there wouldn't be the Sharp Center for Design. OCAD wouldn't have its university status, and I wouldn't have the cover art for these two books. So I am so very grateful, and would like to ask Ron to come forward at this point for speak for a moment.
This is quite awkward for me. I feel really honored to be part of this project in the marginal way that I am. Tim has been really supportive of my work over the decades, and we've known each other thanks to John Metcalf, who we had met in Ottawa. That's an aside. This is such a gift to be part of a project, the writing of that involves the writing of Clarke Blaise, an author I admire enormously, and though he probably doesn't remember, when I taught at York in the late 70s and Clarke was there, I remember him being introduced at a faculty meeting, and I immediately tried to read everything and that he's ever written. So he has been a quiet fan behind the scenes. Final reference that Tim was so generously made about OCAD. Those images are in part derived, they're tiny ink drawings that I used to do and have done and carry on doing, that were stimulated by the really great architect Will Alsop. And as we were developing the collaborative process that, you know, you can see the result of a few blocks from here. And Will's practice as an architect is always to collaborate with the people for whom he's going to design, though he has a very large team. But he always used to say, you know, this is all part of what happens around tables. The whole history of culture happens around tables in some way or another. The discourse happens around the tables. And it struck me at the time, working with him, and it seemed to me the outline that Tim made of these two books, all the people who have collaborated in the conversations or the text about Clarke's work, they're all part of that site of discourse. So Tim, thank you so much for your support, and thank you, Guernica, for agreeing that Tim should use what seemed to me at first quite arbitrary images to attach to Clarke Blaise, but maybe the discourse is the key to the imagery. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you, everybody. This is a special gathering because it brings together a book about me by people, in many cases, I didn't know who were behind me, as Ron said. And it's a book about my feelings about literature and about writing and about what one person can say about the world. So it's an inside and outside kind of a book, these two books. you have to buy both, of course, to get the full effect. I always look forward to any attempt, any invitation to come back to Canada. You know, I have a vast family in Winnipeg, and that's where I go usually. And I have a fairly good family in Toronto, who I don't think are here tonight. And I have a large family in the Maritimes. So all of my family, and on my father's side, which is all French, they're in Manchester, New Hampshire, and have never left. So, you know, we're a very rooted family, except for me, who, you know, is scattered around the world like a dandelion clock. I was asked by Tim to read something, and any advice from Tim is something I follow because no one knows me better than Tim. And so this is an essay, part of an essay from the interviews done by my ex-student, my former student at Concordia, Brian Bartlett, who's now a very well-established poet and short story writer and essayist out in the Maritimes. It's an essay called Dancing Over a Sentence. He asked me, Clarke, to ask a tricky question. Are there books of yours that you value more than others? And that's a very tricky question because the writer's answer is always, this is like asking to choose between your children. You know, it's one of those things. CB says, I would say that the significant books to me, the ones that I would really go back to if I were a Blaise scholar, I would say Days and Nights in Calcutta, The Sorrow and the Terror, and maybe I Had a Father, and maybe Time Lord, but certainly Man in His World. Because I felt in Man in His World I had broken out of the mold of autobiographical storytelling, and I was reaching for really improbable and wild structures and contents. And The Meager Tarmac, yes, again, it was a breakthrough in a certain way that I was able to put together what I'd been for 49 years of close, now it's 53 years, of close observations and close experience, though I had never thought of entering their world, that's India's world, through their point of view. I've written about India a lot, but has always been as an outsider. They were to me the significant breakthrough books. Each of the books I've mentioned surprised me. They opened me up. The stories in the North American education and tribal justice didn't open me up. They were already in me, and it was just a matter of getting them out. But you know, throwing myself into the joint family for a year in Calcutta, that demanded an awful lot of adjustment and an awful lot of, well, atonement for going into it with Western ideas and Western preconceptions. Certainly The Sorrow and the Terror was, again, totally investigative. Some people have written to me saying that it is the best way of understanding 9/11, and it's the best way of understanding the Lockerbie tragedy, that those were both directly taken from what we discovered in writing that book, especially Lockerbie, a radio transmitter, exactly like Rayat had made a year earlier in BC, and the Khalistani cells are very much like Al-Qaeda cells, only much, much smaller. You just see how the terrorists, which is what they are, can maintain a perfectly conventional Canadian exterior, friendly, open, laughing, and also plotting to kill. And we were able, when we interviewed members of those cells, this was before they were identified, we were able to figure out who was really an RCMP plant. And even though he was a full member, and he did turn out to be a plant, we spotted him right away, and apparently his colleagues didn't. This was a giant leap because it gave me a very hard attitude towards the kind of terrorism and towards other kinds of terrorism. That got me into a lot of trouble in Ireland a couple of years later when I said that the IRA, to me, was just a matter of power, vanity, and money among the leadership. And that's the way it was among the Sikhs, the way it was among, to me, all sorts of terrorists, like Al-Qaeda, especially when they were started going into third and fourth generations of terrorism business, and it's their family franchise. But the Sorrow and the Terror gave me an operating philosophy about terrorism. The criticisms of Time Lord that are out there are, you know, that I'm essentially a literature professor, not a biographer. I take that at its word, it's true. But what it gave me was an idea of the interrelatedness between technology and the arts that came about in the Victorian era. Because the Victorian era was the great era of technology, the implementation of all the discoveries of the Romantic era, of Humphrey Davy and all those people. The Victorians were Prince Albert creating the Great Exhibition and creating all the technical universities, Glasgow and London and Manchester, that replaced in some ways, certainly augmented, what Oxford and Cambridge were for the gentlemen, and led to Britain's greatest decade, the 1850s, ending with Darwin. Thereafter, the long decline. Because all the other European countries started doubling and tripling their investment in the universities. Well, those are the ideas I would leave you with. You know, in a career that has highs and lows, or that are highs and plateaus, and those are highs to me, working on those books. I think this French book, this is the one I'm writing right now, is also going to be one of those, because it's a stretch for me. I didn't grow up Franco-American. My father was ashamed of his origins and hated Catholicism with a kind of Spanish Civil War hatred. We castrate them, then we string them up, you know, the priests. And he was far more anti-Catholic than my mother. My mother was a sort of intellectually anti-Catholic. My father was viscerally anti-Catholic because something happened to him when he was given away to be a priest in the church. He was the donné, the youngest son. So I was not raised in French. I had a consciousness, of course, of what I was. And every now and then, we visit my aunts, his sisters, in Manchester. It's back up, Manchester, New Hampshire. In Manchester. They never learned to speak English. It was that dense a ghetto. And I picked up curse words and numbers and things like that. But that was about it. My father didn't want to teach me French. And then Brian asks, the main character in your new stories is younger than you, right? About 10 years younger, born in the early 50s, not at the beginning of the 40s as you were. And I say, and his brother, the gifted one, of course, has the muscular dystrophy. That's another book I'm writing right now. Both of them will be out next year. I have muscular dystrophy. My son, my oldest son, died of it a year ago tomorrow. And it's a French-Canadian disease. It's an ethno-specific disease to central Quebec, where my genes originate. It's a dominant disease, so it doesn't matter what my mother contributed. For Manitoba, what can you do for me? Anyway, so I'm writing a novel, a Franco-American novel set in Winooski, Vermont, about two brothers, one who has the disease and one who doesn't, and the collapse at the same time of the Franco-American community, which at one time was very strong and very Quebec-oriented, but over the decades began to simply fade away, and it has faded away now. You have people named Favreau who spell their name F-A-V-R-O, you know, as it's that kind of thing. And the other book is about the genetics of muscular dystrophy and our family as it's tried to deal with his disease and my disease and all the other diseases that are part of our family that have come to claim our lives. So anyway, that's me. That's the books. I hope you. Get a chance to read them. They're fascinating books, if I say so myself. this is one of those moments in which you get 800 pages of Blaisiana, and 400 pages of them were things I said 10, 5, 10, 20, 30, 40 years ago to people. I never collected them, I never read them, I never knew what I had said, but Tim Struthers went back and found them. And I'm amazed at them. I'm, you know, really gratified to find it. And then all of these other people that Tim got together to write essays about the various books that I've written, you know, informed me about what I had done. And so I'm grateful. I'm grateful to you. I'm grateful to Tim. I'm grateful to all of the people who contributed. I'm grateful to the people who listened and ran their tapes, their tape recorders for me. All of the, nothing is ever lost in the universe. Nothing is ever lost. You know, you write something you think is gone, but no, someone has picked it up, someone has found it, someone has preserved it, and these are the books. So thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Clark. Up next, Luciano Iacobelli. All right. Aside from being a good friend, Luciano has made a name for himself, actually, as one of the most visible poets, visual artists, and publishers in Toronto, serving both as a co-owner of Quattro Books, home of the novella, and sole owner of the Lyrical Miracle Press, well known for its handcrafted poetry chapbooks. He himself is the author of numerous chapbooks, several plays, and a quartet of full-length books of poetry, including The Angel Notebook, Painting Circles, which is published in a bilingual English-Spanish edition, and Book of Disorders. His 2011 collection, Book of Disorders, is described as examining the very substance of poetry to discover that when language is dysfunctional, when it is broken and no longer tethered to its use and practicality, it is free to rediscover its own basic textures and possibilities. In 2015, he collaborated with Jens Kohler and Roberto Mara on a project called the Emu Dialogues, described as a literary cult named after a bird improvised from the spare parts of other birds. A bird that never flies because flying is a cliche. A book for anyone who was ever asked the question, why is an orange? And answered, because ice cream has no bones. The Examine Life, the book that we have, is Luciano's first poetry collection with Guernica, long overdue. This is a collection of poems, concrete poetry, and illustrations that unearths the lyricism buried deep in the language and ideas of Western philosophy. It tinkers with that lyricism, bends it, crafts it into a multi-shaped, multi-voice, dynamic poetry that succeeds in capturing thought in transit as it crosses both the heart and mind. As Luciano points out, not only the heart, but the mind sings too. And sometimes the two sing in unison. So here he is to give us a poetic taste of what an examined life is all about. Luciano.
I brought my bodyguard with me today. Thanks, Mike, for taking a chance on this book. It's the kind of book that's easier to write than it is to read. It's not going to be, you know, running off the shelves immediately, because there's a lot of experimentation that goes on in this book, especially at the visual level and also with the tinkering with language. The book is essentially my relationship to Western philosophy. In it, I riff with most of the major philosophers from Plato to the postmodernists. It's like I go into the department store of thought, take inventory. Even though I don't shop there, I like to know that the ideas are there, you know, in case I need one. The piece I'm going to read today is for two voices. Actually, Jens is not my bodyguard. He is my vocal stuntman. He's going to be reading the difficult vocal parts. So, actually, come on up And so the piece is for two voices, and essentially the inspiration for this was Fear and Trembling by Kierkegaard, which is focused on the story of Abraham and Isaac. I'm not going to go into the story of Abraham and Isaac. I think most of us know that one. And it also, as a counterpoint to that, a book by Hegel called Phenomenology of Spirit. So they're the inspiration for these two voices, although there's a lot of distortion and I don't know if I totally represent their ideas, but that's not the point. It's to write poetry, right? Okay. So we're just going to read this one section from the book and that'll be it. The night before the journey, Abraham sweated a new inwardness, one without generalities, and in the morning he quietly packed his asses, a kiss but no words to his wife, the bulk of Mount Moriah on his tongue, all formula and abstraction crushed by the weight, animal burning in the flames of self-commitment, rooted in subject, not thinking or talking existence, but immersed in it. To speak would be to croak in a personal swamp, to leave normal talk and immigrate to tongues. He saw only specific things that morning, not fields, but individual stalks swaying in the wind. No path, but a moving eye under him. Killing Isaac would be a hollow act. There was no longer any son to kill. The parental and filial roles already dismantled. Father and progeny already canceled in his merciless subjectivity.
Spirit aims for a future without lines or angles, movement striving towards non-movement, the square and the triangle arguing, but creating the circle, having none of the corners of what came before, is growing consciousness, the spirit's desire to photograph a non-event, the very whole that is the source of all participation. And for this beautiful paradox, all the massive devastations are necessary. Clash of wills, photographed violence, the archived spirit, filmed history, framed in its evolving physique, narcissist, adolescent, kissing its own biceps, huge David form slaying the formlessness and composing neatly the bombed buildings, the fallen walls, the empty quiet ruins, posing for the lens. Tourists standing between Roman pillars or the quiet battlefield. The empty concentration camp is spirit scanning itself. Struggle, digesting struggle, observing one limb black, the other white, fighting. Forward the autobiography of spirit acted and the performance complete. Spirit thoroughly cinema, the disappearance in the movie theater, watching its former appearances.
Father and son set off toward the mountain. They arrive and tremble in the preposterous dark. In the morning they walk silently up the rock. The father, driven by a writhing passion for nothing possible, climbs a promise he'll keep. He is aged by the impending sacrifice. The filial artery opened, drained. The father's new face not trusted by the son. It is a cliff loaded with suicidal leaps into a lawless void. It's the end of fatherhood. Reason. No words. Knife. Decision. Action. Blood.
Matter. is distance traveled by spirit, inward journeyed, outward thought extended into space and time, is how long a thought travels before it becomes thoughtlessness. The goal of matter is to outwit its own mass, to disappear. Look closely at a photo and notice the stillness. Is the invisible come full term, greater and lighter than the image frozen in the absolute gaze of spirit, staring back from timelessness where it fully knows its roundness, the current flowing, self-aware home, coming the return from self-imposed exile, from appearance, birth, death, decay, the evolution process unprocessed, all shapes dismissed, spirit with no nature, the art existing but not the art object, no marble figure chiseling its actualization but realized bird flying without wings, ingested by pure flight is future.
The end of simple moments. Man and boy eat a silent breakfast, while the mountain and its complications expects them. Before father departs with son on a 3-day journey through the obliterate terrain, he packs the asses, goes in, places his lips on his wife's cheek. It is the kiss of an emptying vessel pouring out a son's death. Though spared the sacrificial blade, the boy will be killed by the father's detachment, the old man's leap into a whole thought, the whole thought's leap into him.
Focus of pure spirit, the new, more perfect state tossed to and fro amid the accidents perishable, nature's exhibitions, manifold self-repeating play on we, inducing via conservatrix, spirit self-warring, otherwise always otherwising, not peaceful, goal stern, working in the dark toward agonized philological monuments, languages, speech, history, the fragmented, transcended random cubes and squares, grazed on by the poetical genius, lively of images, is to sublimely surpass itself all and annihilate outworn connection.
Abraham commanded Isaac to go with him. By his father's voice alone, the son knew not to expect what's expected of fathers. For the mountain had summoned Abraham. The fruit was being called back by the branch. Nature had changed its nature. Abraham had stuck his finger into actuality, tasted it, asked, how does one lift bitter complication off the tongue?
Feet smoothing the stones, the whole thoughtful consideration underlies nature, yet dwells far away from it as an operation, a nourishment, a goal, energizing mental visions shaped into phenomena, but neither the sun nor the planets have any consciousness that they are pushed by reason. And every passion, too, is rational thought with current and undertow, the abstract, materialized spirit converted into methodical flesh. The unfolding spirit always awaits its sequel tendency toward a central point, seeks its unity in exceeding itself the way matter wishes only to become antimatter. History wants catastrophe to pound flesh into self-awareness, to make the tongue speak, far forward silence, disappearance, voice verging towards indivisible spirit strikes the set. Vast altar of the imagination has been aiming at sacrificing itself.
The glittering knife offered all to the elevation, and all was returned. Abraham jumped into eternity, and eternity jumped into him. If I could stop him on his way home, I'd look for holes in his face, peep into what he knows. I'd look for bumps or marks on his skin, for the braille and hieroglyphic of his leap. But most likely nothing would be demonstrated except his fascination for the dead animals by the roadside and the children playing around the crows and the decay.
Gloomy satisfaction. That is God's slow and bloody realization, the exhibition of self worked out, successive panoramas of sin and suffering history, unfolds realpolitik that results from self-interest are not real, and neither is the self-interest, for it is driven by a greater interest, object of desire, this fixed system outside all egotism, not yet objectified, the blank penetration of spirit, and we who help to build its house will be shut out of the structure. History arrives at our own exclusion. God's will is slaughter, bench. God's mental torture, tedious discipline, unactualized essence, trying to squeezes itself into comprehensive design. Freedom is idea not chained to fire, earth, water, and air. The house is built to keep out that without which it couldn't be built. The grand design vanquishes us in the momentous collisions between contingencies, the thorn, the worm, crushed to pieces by the machine, and reason too will never enter the finished mansion.
Abraham woke up removed from generalities, his tongue scraped of universals. Fearing he'd sound like a babbling infant speaking a personal language, he stayed mute while he ate breakfast with his wife and child. No verbal fig leaf to cover his loins, no crutches alone in the subjective, nothing to mediate him, no signs that could bridge him to others, his life concentrated in the deeply personal, uncommunicable point, promise of resignation, single penetrating stare, sharpened knife that cuts a son's throat. Parenthesized within himself and silent, his teeth ached over the food he chewed, the taste of sheer edge that no principle could sweeten, the raw distance between cliff ledge and ground, the panorama digesting him. Thank you.
All right. Next up, Bill Turpin. For the purposes of full disclosure, as the politicians like to say, I have known Bill Turpin since the days we worked together on tabloid journals in the 1970s. This was a place where reporting the news basically meant creating it. Such as the time our wonderful editor by the name of Johnny Vader, who came long before Vader, put a guy in a wheelchair on top of Mount Royal in Montreal, being pushed by a woman in a pillbox hat. Atop a blurry photo, a headline to the effect that JFK was alive. And that sold over a million copies that week, all right? All to say that this was a hotbed, a laboratory for the art of fiction. A place where you could let your imagination run wild, which has often led me to wonder why it took Turpin some 40 years to write his first novel. However, from the moment Max's Folly across my desk, or rather monitor, I knew it was I deserved to be part of the Guernica family. This was writing that was not only innovative, fresh, and funny within a story that was unique, but also a writing that had a heartbeat to it. The combined elements of satire with a passion for exposing wrongdoing and coming to terms with home truths that we all have to face at some time or other. On top of that, Bill turned out to be that one in a million writer who is both easy to work with and who sweats the details. Of Max's Folly, Silver Donald Cameron says, a journalist adrift in time, a cast of wacky characters, an astute writer who deeply enjoys language. What's not to like? Max's Folly is a delight. Worldly, quirky, droll, and utterly engaging. Stephen Kimber, author of What Lies Across the Waters, The Real Story of the Cuban Five, says, in Max's Folly, Bill Turpin leads us on a rollicking roller coaster ride through Max's non-linear time-space continuum, in quotes, as he pieces together the memories of a fully lived life now slipping away from him. A marvelous debut novel from a major new talent. To quote from Bill's own bio, Bill Turpin has worked most of his career as a journalist, first in Montreal and more recently in Halifax, but has also afflicted government and the communications world. He is currently living off his wits while studying to be a gadfly. Turpin is married and the father of two cats. Let's bring him up on stage.
Thank you. Thanks, Mike. I'll give you just a bit of a setup here. The premise of this is that our hero, Max, has had a series of personal tragedies, the most recent of which it was the death of his beloved wife. And now, his son, his only family, has determined that he has dementia. And is getting ready to put Max in assisted care. So Max's response is that, or his understanding is that, no, it's not dementia. He is a time traveler, always has been. And that what people are interpreting as memory issues are simply the result of his impaired time traveling abilities, right? We all know that could cause all kinds of confusion. So that's the basic premise. So I just have two sections that I'd like to read. One is quite short, and the other is it's interminable, really. But I'll do my best. This is the first piece is called The Yellow Pencil of Doubt. And it's the first of two parts that describe Max's apostasy in the end. And the second piece is more general. So I'll start with The Yellow Pencil of Doubt. It is the day after Max's sixth birthday, and he's attending Sunday school in the basement of the local United Church. A lot of kids are sitting on cheap wood and metal chairs, waiting for the thing to end. But for Max, this is a special moment. At the end of every class, the teachers give new yellow pencils marked HB in gold paint to every student who had a birthday during the previous week. These are, without question, pencils from God. We celebrate three birthdays today, says the kind-looking woman who runs the class. Please come up and receive your pencils as I read your name. Max is already standing when the third name is read out. It is not his. He is still standing when the kids are set free to find their parents upstairs. He's flushed with embarrassment and, most important, alarm. These pencils are awarded by God, who knows absolutely everything that everyone is doing at all times. He knows more than either Santa or the Queen. God would not forget to give Max his pencil. God never forgets. Moreover, good behavior is not a requirement for receiving a pencil, because God is all forgiving. Max's mind stays with this point. You don't have to be good, like Santa insists, to get your pencil. Every week, Max sees bad kids get their pencils. But on his birthday week, Max is denied. There are only two possible explanations. God hates Max and will send him to hell when he dies. Just like Max's Catholic friend said. Or, there is no God. It's a crossroads. One truth leads to hell, the other to salvation. Max frantically reviews the problem one more time and then internalizes the pro-Max conclusion. There is no God. So Max will not go to hell. That still leaves a big question. Why are so many important people lying to him about this? So, I mentioned that Max is a time traveler. So what happens in the book is that when he's faced with the realization that he cannot avoid assisted care, he takes off on his final time trip to find his wife somewhere in time. Somewhere in time where they were happy and prosperous and stay with her there until whatever the end turns out to be. So here, in most of Max's career, he is a journalist. And in this scene, this chapter, he is editing a paper in Halifax, a sort of a bratty tabloid. And it's the number 2 paper. Pardon me? Oh. So it's a bratty tabloid, but not the Sun. I want to make that clear. I almost forgot where I was. In this, we start here where Max is on the phone with the publisher, also known as the Smiling Cobra. And the Smiling Cobra, by way of background, his goal in life, his professional life, is to fire Max if he can just find a reason. And the other thing I should warn you about is Max doesn't remember anyone's names in his life. Right, in this final trip, he goes all over his life looking for his wife, but he does not remember the names of any of the people he met. It's like lots of us rearranging it already. Think the first time you start to worry about your memories when you can't remember people's names, right? Well, that was the guy that fired me. What's his name? Right? So people remember roles, or some of us do. So that's the way Max remembers his life, is the roles of the people he met. So here, the Smiling Cobra's on the phone with Max in the newsroom. And it starts off with the Smiling Cobra talking. I am not going to make His Excellency, the Archbishop, walk through your newsroom. The Smiling Cobra hisses. It's bad enough that you refuse to go to his office. We don't have to explain ourselves to the police, the state, or the church, Max says. If they want to discuss our content, then they can come here. He sets off for the publisher's office. A walk that he now loves. After working almost 15 years in a strip mall, he's delighted by the paper's airy new building, and the paper's making money and employing almost 100 people. Best of all, the owner is giving Max most of the credit for the success, making it difficult for the Cobra to fire him, despite his rabid desires. Max secretly agrees with the Cobra's analysis of their success. And that is, they're in a growing population, and that means a growing newspaper. Nonetheless, he graciously accepts any praise that comes his way. So when Max arrives in the Cobra's office, he sees that the Archbishop and his assistant are already present. The Cobra sits nervously behind his desk, which bears a huge new nameplate saying simply, Publisher. The assistant, wearing the requisite black shirt and clerical collar, has turned his chair to face the empty one intended for Max. The Archbishop is beside him in a well-tailored gray suit. His face is fleshy and heavy-jowled, and oddly, his chair is set closer to the back wall so that he isn't facing anyone directly. The Cobra does the introductions, repeating the phrases Excellency as many times as possible. The assistant leans back toward the Archbishop and mumbles unintelligibly. The holy man utters an equally unintelligible reply. Max, says the cobra, as you know, His Excellency has come here today to discuss a serious matter. Father Peter, the assistant says helpfully. Ah, Father Peter, Max replies. I thought as much. Max has no idea who Father Peter is. The assistant leans toward the Archbishop and mumbles again. His Excellency replies. Max is astonished to realize that the two clerics aren't speaking English. French, or the third language that Max would recognize, Spanish. The cobra nods, apparently believing that this is how these things are done. His Excellency says there's a lot of His Excellency says there is a lot of gossip in Father Peter's former parish, the assistant says. Max says, Vous parlez français? Silence. Habla espanol? He asks. Still silence. Father, I assume I should call you Father. May I ask which of God's languages you and His Excellency are speaking? The two of them confer before the assistant turns to Max and says, Latin. Have you given up living languages for Lent? Max asks. The cobra, the assistant, and the archbishop all flush with anger. In the case of His Excellency, this is an impressive sight. The two holy men engage in an extended conversation. The archbishop is a holy man, Max, the cobra explains. Well, there's no shortage of them. What's so special that we can't speak English? First, the assistant says, this is not the Lenten season. Although, we suspect you know that. Second, His Excellency holds a deep distrust of the media, something you have just reinforced. By conversing in Latin, we can deprive you of a direct quote that you would use out of context. But your translations are full and accurate, are they not? Max asks. The assistant smiles. Maybe. Maybe not. Max switches to French, annoying both the cobra and His Excellency. But the assistant doesn't miss a beat. He translates Max's French into Latin. Got me, Max thinks. In French, the assistant explains that any coverage of Father Peter will do great harm to Catholics. For Christ's sake, the cobra says, Max, Father, whatever, would you please speak English? Max smiles broadly. The holy men stare at the cobra in silent rebuke. Oh, sorry, Your Excellency. The Archbishop resumes in Latin. His Excellency is concerned that coverage of this regrettable matter will undo all the good work Father Peter has done for Nova Scotia and Halifax, not to mention centuries of good work by the Church, the assistant explains. For example, we fear that the youth and gymnastic clubs Father Peter established will fail. Perhaps even more importantly, we are concerned that publicity in irresponsible journals will unnecessarily shake the faith of some parishioners, which would be very painful for them. Further, it has been dealt with in a most severe manner. Max raises an eyebrow, prompting the cleric to add that Father Peter has been sent to work with the poor under very difficult conditions. Where? I'm authorized to tell you that he is in Latin America. The cobra is again nodding, satisfied at a job well done. Now Max is feeling less charitable. I assume that by irresponsible journals you mean this one, the one that I edit. The archbishop and the assistant confer in Latin. Yes, that is correct. We believe society underestimates the effect of the gutter press on most people's emotions. Quite so, Max says. Your competitor would never publish this story. They know about it? Max asks. They have known for some time, the assistant replies smugly. Both of the holy men wear the approving smiles reserved for newspapers that know how to cooperate for the greater good. Again, the archbishop speaks through his assistant. We Christians have a saying. It's God's job to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. Are you a religious man, Max? When I was six, says Max, my best friend explained that we couldn't be friends because I was a Protestant and would burn in hell. And then there was an unfortunate incident with a pencil. Since then, I have not been noticeably religious. How about you? There is one more thing, the assistant says. Father Peter is a good man whose fall from grace is punishment enough. And here I speak only for myself because it is a difficult topic. It has to be recognized that some young boys have dark hearts. What do you mean exactly? Well, in some cases they learn how to manipulate human weakness at an early age. And they can be seductive. They are often the predators, not the victims. Max realizes that he has been unconsciously measuring the distance between himself and the assistant. Half a step would put him well within striking distance. Yes, he says, hoping the assistant can hear the malevolence in his voice. We all understand how seductive these young slatterns can be. No adult could be expected to resist their wiles. The archbishop goes red, apparently on the verge of summoning the devil. He whispers to the assistant who relays the message, "You so-called journalists are not careful about what you say and write. You don't worry about consequences. If you are not careful, you may come to regret that." Max stands. "Indeed. Well, I'll certainly give some thought to everything you've said, including the apparent threat that you just uttered. By the way, your affliction aphorism was originally about newspapers, before being appropriated by lay religious writers. And for the record, I lean toward afflicting the comfortable." The smiling Colbert chimes in. "I can assure your excellency that you have nothing to be concerned about as far as this paper goes." There follow the usual goodbyes and a few lame jokes about rainy weather. The great man and his assistant are at the door when Max asks a final question. "Your excellency, I asked if you were a religious man, but you haven't answered." The archbishop looks at Max as if he's just set his hair on fire. In English, he says, "I'm the archbishop." After enduring a warning from the Colbert to spike any story about Father Peter, Max heads straight for city desk. "Is Mother Mary here?" he asks. Mother Mary has earned the nickname for her tendency to mother everyone in the newsroom, although she's the same age. She's also the most devout soul in the newsroom, but hell on wheels if you're an errant priest. "She's covering a bank robbery," the city editor says. "Well, when she gets back, tell her I want a story on some local pederast priest." "Any details?" "All I know is his name is Father Peter. He's been relocated and probably worked in or near the city." "Oh, and the idiots at the other paper are sitting on the story." Thank you.
Thank you so much, Bill. Next up, we have Brenda Clews, and we're actually going to have Karen Shenfeld, one of our other Guernica poets, introduce her.
Well, the word multi-talented is often used very loosely these days. But I would say that that word, multi-talented, honestly describes my friend and colleague, Brenda Clews. She is a multimedia poet, visual artist, dancer, videographer, and impresario who pursues all of her endeavors with aplomb. She's very well known on the Toronto scene for her readings, dances, and exhibits. And she's very greatly appreciated for running the poetry and music salons at which many of us here have read and performed. Luciano's Lyrical Miracle Press published her chapbook, The Luminist Poems, in 2013. Today, I'm greatly honored to be introducing Brenda. I met her several years ago, but then we realized that we had both been published when we were students at York University in the same journal by Irving Layton. And I think that if Irving, who is also a friend of Leonard Cohen's, so they both have passed away, I think if Irving could be here today, he'd be sitting there like a very proud father to see that one student, myself, is introducing Brenda Clews. So please come up here, Brenda, to read from your newest book, Tidal Fury.
So thank you, Karen, for that wonderful introduction. And hello, everyone. What a great crowd, and I'm so honored to have my book, Tidal Fury, included in this roster of terrific writing by terrific authors. Tidal Fury has been a long time coming. I wrote the first draft during intense months in 2006. And then it sat in a drawer until 2013 when Guernica accepted it. Much of the artwork is from the same time period or close to it. And the book is really a paean to coming out from under, breaking free of entrapments, speaking our own voices, learning how to silence the critic within so that we may give of our vision. Our poetry. It is a book composed of many styles of writing, poetry, prose, theory, epistles, and even half of a telephone conversation. And it's a book, I hope, to inspire you to write yourself, however you may, to break down forms of what the forms poetry can take. In that our poetry, because we are each poems, our poetries can be expressed in myriad ways and like, you know, go for it. Be raw with some polish. Be your own creative muse, and you will understand when you see what I'm going to do when I say be your own fierce creative muse. So I'm indebted to Michael Mirolla for his support as a publisher and editor, and for he's a force on the poetry and writing scene. He's published so many people. He's brought fine writing to public attention, and I'm in such admiration. And my dear friend Luciano Iacobelli, who launched a book this afternoon. It was fabulous. He's another wonderful publisher on the Toronto scene. And he's very supportive of writing and painting ventures, including mine. And this has helped me to show my artwork and to publish. So I'd like to thank him. And I'd like to thank John Otten for offering a wonderful blurb back cover. And for his support as a poet friend, and for the collaborations we've done and are continuing to do, because we put in an application for the Honest Ed's show in February. Gabriel Quigley appeared on the scene as Guernica's videographer, and his reading of Tidal Fury and his understanding of the poetry. And the book trailer he brilliantly edited and produced has been amazing. Many thanks. And Anna Geisler, Guernica's beautiful and hardworking publicist, thank you. So lastly and most importantly, I would like to thank my two children, Adrian and Kira, one of whom is here, the other is still on her way from Owen Sound, who simply accepted a mother. No, she's here. Hi! Woo! Fantastic. Who simply accepted a mother who sometimes sat staring at nothing with a pencil and a notebook in her lap, who was often mute, busy in the silent ways of poetry, for their unending deep love and support. So thank you. So first I begin with two poems about the mysteries of writing, and then I'm going to perform. So be forewarned. Writings of who? I seek who allows me to write. In the sunlit corridors, perhaps, my eclipsed twin, who answers through this writing. Who is the narrator within conversing with me in these words that I relay to you as we converse? Who haunts us from within? Who is writing? Surely not our speaking voice. Poetry evokes us like the gradual lightening of dawn. If the trope of light didn't burn, corrode our vision, that is. Sometimes I want to keep my secrets secret. Down the long corridors of time, our shadows cast into the future. The doors open and close and open, the spurious wind blowing through. Shutters cannot stay shut. We are ghosts moving through ourselves, haunted by ourselves. Can we have thoughtless words? A discourse bereaved of its cry? Insomnia. When I obsessed about writing the way I do a lover, I stopped sleeping. Now I keep a notebook beside me, its open white sheets, to write blindly in the night with a pencil without seeing. Words flow between the imaginal and the real, reflecting, shaping. All day, tired and euphoric, such intense nights of lovemaking. Okay, so. On the beach, I see her on sea walks in her long black skirt. She gazes out to sea. Grief on her face, wet from the spray of the rocks that she stands on, and something indefinable lit from within, but subtle, like sunset spilling out of her eyes. But the coast is empty. I don't know who I am. Me, her, or you? Or a transfigured god, a Medusa lady, The curls in my hair tightly coiled in the sea spray, an image maker. Blue dancers leap and fall, disappearing bubbles of sea foam. You are the edge of the waves that tip over when the peak cannot hold itself aloft and falls. Like a dancer letting go of taut tension and plunging. Or perhaps it is words that fall into froth. We are standing on the shore of oceans that encompass the earth. Let me bathe in your words, salt rinsing raw passion. Our vision infinite as the skyline. Am I in love with you and who? My unbidden holy muse. The Medusa. In this emotional storm of words, she who turns life into art with her gaze. Flesh becomes stone, pigment, pixel, celluloid. The immortalizer who kills us. I weep on an altar of rainbow serpents on shed skin. The coils in my jewel-studded hair cut. A mass of deathly serpent eyes. Muse. Medusa is my muse, and her snakes appear everywhere. Grammars. Monsieur, you are a reference outside the writing for whom the writing was written. Your eyes read as the reader's reads. You were conceived as a literary device, and then I discovered we knew each other intimately. Remember the night when you, without closure, embraced me, when I disappeared into your vastness, became lost in you, lost me. Do you remember how we, two sighs enfolded in each other? Breath of love, I speak of romance tonight. Forgive me, monsieur. Afterwards, we did not speak of it. The surface of the water that resists before you fall in, that edge of sweetness. Now, mon amour, it is like we are sitting in a darkened room with a screen of scenes before us, our hands close but not touching. You are so far away. Thank you.
Thank you, Brenda, for that insanely wonderful and vibrant performance. Last but not least, we have George Eliot Clarke. George Eliot Clarke is poet, novelist, librettist, playwright, and scholar. An Africadian, he has won national and international awards for his poetry. Currently Parliamentary Poet Laureate, Clarke is also the E.J. Pratt Professor of Canadian Literature at the University of Toronto. Canticles I is George Eliot Clarke's epic work in progress. It's the first in a tetralogy, and the first book, which is this one, was actually split into two books because originally it was over 800 pages. So today George will be presenting the first half, Canticles I 2016, and in spring 2017 we'll actually be releasing the second half, Canticles I 2017. Book one of the Canticles puts into dialogue, as dramatic monologues, those who fostered the transatlantic slave trade or who demonized the image of the Negro in the Occident, as well as those who struggled for liberation and anti-racism. In this work, Dante can critique Christopher Columbus and Frederick Douglass can upbraid Abraham Lincoln. Elizabeth Barrett Browning can muse on her African racial heritage and its implications for childbearing, while Karl Marx can excoriate Queen Victoria. Paul Watkins described the book like this: "These canticles abound with polyphony. Clarke echoes slave and imperialist debates that stretch back to Cleopatra, provides new voice to Marie-Joseph Angélique and Phyllis Wheatley, and revises and reworks history with the powers of a firebrand poet in full control of his craft. As spirited and incendiary as Ezra Pound's Careless Cantos, Canticles is a manifesto that tells us, howling, screeching, testifying, rhyming, that poetry makes things happen, and that it has as much to tell us as ever. Please give a warm welcome to George Eliot Clarke."
Oh my golly, how wonderful to be here. And I just want to say that I think that throughout my poetry career, I have been desperate to finally arrive at this point where I would have this wonderful symbol, a Guernica Editions, on a book by me. And I got to say, and I want to join the chorus of folks who said thank you to Michael for making all these various wonderful works possible. And I was really glad to see Luciano again today, and I hope to see you many more launches and so forth of your own work and others as well. And I just want to remind Luciano and myself that 20 years ago, I know I shouldn't say that, I shouldn't admit it, but 20 years ago, he had a bookstore in Little Italy here. I think it was on Clinton. On Clinton, all right. I used to go there. I was teaching at Duke University at the time. And every time I came to Toronto, I'd go to Lucha's store. And guess which books I would buy? Guernica. And I've got a whole collection of Guernica titles because I've always admired the design. And not just the design, but for crying out loud, the writers. And how wonderful it is to be in that company. I think it really is an extremely significant press, and I'm glad, really happy to be part of it now. And also, I want to encourage all of you to start your own Guernica collections today. If you haven't already got a collection going, get started now, because I think these are really significant works. And I'm really happy to be part of it all again. I want to thank Anna for the great introduction of my work, and I'm realizing it's been a long afternoon. I'm not going to overstay my welcome. I'll launch into this. I'll just say quickly that this is a work that deals with slavery and imperialism. And as I've taught myself to say in the last couple of weeks, these are ongoing issues. It's not over yet. We may think that given the various liberation struggles, and including Cuba in the 1950s, regardless of what people think about Fidel Castro today, we need to remember that he was overthrowing an extremely corrupt and oppressive government in Cuba back in 1959. And we also need to remember the whole history of decolonization. And the reason why we have a history of decolonization is that we have a history of colonization that precedes it, which is, of course, for most people who were subjugated by imperialism, quite horrible and full of human rights abuses, for which there will never be probably reparations. And in fact, the reparations could never be paid because the abuses that were suffered are impossible to be compensated for by money. As a matter of fact, the best compensation would just be for people to move out of various palaces and just turn the keys over. I think that would be great, you know. The Queen says, you know, gee whiz, I've had my 60 plus years on the throne. It's all been very good. Thank you very much. But I want to make up for the imperialism of my ancestors. So I'm just going to turn all the palaces over to all of those former colonized peoples from the Caribbean and from Africa who made the money that made us wealthy, for crying out loud, and let them. And in fact, I'm going to ask my descendants to serve them. Just as, you know, I guess even for a day would be kind of nice, you know, to have Prince William showing up as a butler. Sort for poor folks who have just been brought over first class on British Airways flights from Jamaica or from Trinidad or from Barbados or what have you, or let's say for a week, and have him serve them, and along with the Duchess as well, Kate, serving everybody. That would be good. I mean, just to get started on some notion of reparations. You know, and what kind of news stories those would be anyway, for CBC and even for the National Post to get after, and Conrad Black could be interviewed about, well, whether he thinks this is a proper way for things to turn out or not. Then he might think about turning over his house to some folks and so on, just to get into the spirit of things. It is Christmas after all, almost. Anyway, sorry for that long and partly jesting introduction. I should get into the reading. The poems cover 2,000 years of history. This is only the first half. So we get up to 1830. And then the second half is basically from 1830 to 1949. So only 100 years in the second half. But basically, of course, 100 years of very important history. So I want to begin by reading this screed, which is titled Damnation Litany. And now you are damned, and that is damned, and this is damned, and they are damned. Whoever they are, however virtuous they are, the damned farmer damns stones for he plows up gravestones, a damnable crop, and the damned wino virgin feels fat snakes plunger her sex shaggy as an unweeded garden, and the damned backward gutter angels imminent cripples simpering in taverns drunk all night pretty hours and drunk every slam down dawn are damnably teetotally tipsy due to childhoods of collapse and lapses of nerve and or judgment and their spunking and strumpets lapse and the fevered romantic poets damn their licking of lies, their tubicular odes, their tear street sonnets that don't heal but madden, their twilight tinted ballads that unmask them as being too Frankenstein ugly for amnesty. If their face value is honesty, damnable still is each bombed out mouth. Next, each smoked out sex, damn their tombs, cracking open their skulls. Damnable are sleepwalkers among pews. Damnable are shameless sham preachers. Damn disgraceful it is that doves bash against church bells and drop down dead. And damn every slave's blue-printed, fingerprinted ass and every slave ship's moans venerous molestations. And damn the invaluable redemption of praying rapists. The best slut is damned. Damnable is excavated scum, the gold bits surfed from muck, and bankers unsheathing pitiless daggers. Damnable is the horse dissipated into glue, a slimy skank writhing in a ditch, a man axing her as he likes. Both are damned. Damnable are scholars who vampire their subjects. Damnable are assassins' memoirs. Damned is that taxing load of cranks, the legislature. So was dredged up the Bank of England. So was dug up the Bank of America. Damnable, enterprising slavery, luster-destroying slavery, the never-temporary insanity of imperialism, all come to the concussive conclusion. Damnation. A stone broken off a cave front, the rupture wounding a messiah, sees crimson spilled down, damnably. Next, obscene insects cavorting, damnably. Damnable are our sins. Damnable is the long end of the short life. Damnable is that screwdriver twixt your thighs, the dark lead transfixing, poisoning, and damn your shriveled, unshrived lips, and damn your unrefurbished household, and damn your truckling to homicide, and damn your chopped up fingers, and damn your ruinous, murderous wine, and damn your night elongated, dawn extinguished lamp, and damn your bad, 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 bad blood, and damn your Atlantic that's cheery, and damn your sea shade, gall-broken shells, and damnable is the shark wolfing down your legs, damnable are the yellow-toothed Caucasians, damnable is milk drawn off from maggots, damnable is whiskey as dull as water, damnable is a stove used as a confessional, damnable is the confessional used as a urinal, damnable are clanging coins, hissing meat, damnable be the oinking ass and the neighing dog, and damned are shittic lions, and damnable is a nun's sex tighter than a keyhole, and damn all Puritans who shake, ejaculating, sobbing, damn the bow lashing a fiddle, damn the yellow moon that's green cheese and banjoed blues, damn Democrats undone, whimpering. Damnable is the rain's violent sorrow. Damnable is clouded over silver. Damnable are panties springing tentacles. Damnable is lightning flowered from soil. Damnable is the stab wound masquerading as a scratch. Damn the volcanic excrement of tyrants, just what their economies are founded upon. Damn all those who confuse the great chain of being with the food chain. Damn all law books unused for heating brothels. Damn saints who die by gallows and not by guillotine. Damn presidential advisors and presidential Jezebels. Damn the aquatic cemetery of the Middle Passage. Damnable is the nasty fucker who shits on a womb. Damn the bugger who won't squirt hot seed into a minx. Damnable is the little death that comes as quick as a cold comes on. And damned is your deviant dehiscence just line up and manure the fields. And damn the sabotage of blue stockings, the liquidations of ladies amid pillows. And damn the sweet, digestible turds of politicians. Damnable, their jaws dripping loathing, their souls all broken up inside. And damn all those politicals who either stand on the Constitution or who hide behind the Bible. Damn all that's abnormally normal. And damn your caviling genitalia, your brain stymied genitalia. And damn your cavalier caca odor in Parliament. And damn your tongue you cure with leper's lice. And damn your unimprovable vocabulary. Damnable is the yellow fever, the black death. Damnable is the prevaricating fornicator. Damnable is the Republican as resolute as quicksand. Damn breath that reeks like the smell of wet paint. Damn all school picnic pedophiles and all fraudsters with delinquent accounts. Damn all juveniles who lack discipline. Break out the damned belt and use it. And damn executioners who like their prey cornered and castrated and killed like that dog Caesar and that canine Richard III. Damned are slavery's pallid brats and freckled bastards. And damn all jolting, quaking, back-breaking bitches. And damn daylight that aches and burns like acid. And damn all insatiable, goblet-smashing widows. Damn poets whom Lorca-like end in a ditch. Or whom like Rilke end in a rose garden. Or whom like Pound end in a gondola. Or whom like Yeats end up a senator. Damnable is the insolent ipseity of the poet laureate. Damned is his semi-arousal due to Sicilian Marcella. Damnable is the rat's tongue in his scorpion's jaw. Damnable are his sermons, impudent as grunts. Let him cough up black tar and green mucus, unhealthy bits of hair, dust, shit. His epic is more broken than most. He's uncomfortable with damnation, but not unfamiliar with the deed. His prominent exhaustion damns him. His overabundant laughter damns him. His somber whining is self-damning. Damn the prison of the poem. Damn a smoky penis's imprecise negritude. Damn the raving tunes of the insidious versifier. Damn the uninhibited exhibitionist poet. Damn luminous Venus, false-faced muse. Damn the minor bards wheezing. Damn the poetaster setting language askew. Damn the tidal wave meter of mystics. Damn this epic jotted out of ink and bile. Damn the unprofitable mishmash of voices. Damn fresh silence with its black tatters. Damn every sullen phrase of my glittering voice. Thank you. That's So on to history, and I'll just read a couple more, maybe three at the most, Holmes. The Testament of Ulysses X, and this is based on the Odyssey of Homer. You can't write a self-respecting epic without touching on Homer, but this is Homer viewed in a very skewed way, thanks to the autobiography of Malcolm X, because in the autobiography of Malcolm X, he mentions Ulysses X. So I was thinking, this is the testament of Ulysses X via Malcolm X, via Homer. Destroy, destroy, crumble into smoke, ash, stink. Debilitated are her gods, all in horizontal corpses now. and rot reek from every field, every temple. Their armor extraordinarily is worthless as a chopped off arm. Their bronze, their brass is ludicrous as sunflowers landscaping a grave. No, beauty alleviates this disaster, whelped by Helen, diabolical Bella, that unmistakable amoral beauty. If only Menelaus had beaten his wife, Helen, like some dog, like the bitch she was born as. I think a gutter had been her alchemist's cauldron, that she abracadabra'd ex-slime-formed floozy to guilt-show monarch. Then her betrayal could have been born, and thousands of brave sons, fathers, husbands, allowed to plow and press anthologies of grapes, pour out dramatic honey, and build on pied-à-terre gushing wine and mead, not endure the chaotic tangle of wave and torch, the distempered gravity of spears hooking out hearts or eyes, nor smoke as gloomy as beige, nor cathedral crafted calligraphy lettering premature obits, nor the turmoil of wounds, the exhaust of blood, nor arrowed ghosts, their chests bristling missiles, nor skid marks of toppling chariots, nor lightning fate's graffiti tensing the atmosphere. But Helen turned out to be the slushy buttress of a pimp's bedroom. Now Troy is a moon-singed hell. The cut-out crescent moon is a candle-wick afire. This light has an idiotic friendship with the dark, for it is more a tintorella than it is moonlight. It is curiously drab, but suitable is the somber shade, closing upon indignant fisticuffs that ground so many Greeks into this merciless foreign soil. The Trojans attacked tactlessly like a trove of homicidal suicides. They perished like cobwebbed snow, a glut, an entangled, insidious parliamentary silence, impatient to be bones, a grand stink, springing up the spring. Even their horses become monotonous sculptures, each one a doleful mirror of maggots, a rat's nest of snakes. I'll take to the silvery, teetering waves, the sprinkled moonlight, to spelunk again the consecrated cavity within my wedded wife, and forgive my prodigal panting with Kirke, abandon her gynecological nursery, men's torn out entrails visible, their gashed eyes decorating forks, if only, only if. Kirke is a blood-purple Venus, a marini Venus, and I am her vinegary nigger, homeboy, black imp, the backstabbing sailor, the avant-garde assassin, the Jack the Ripper Romeo, the bottom of the pile, nigger in the woodpile, who flashes all 32 teeth, even the molars, that sets my canines gnashing, Kirke's drooling pussy until she quivers, gushes, squirts, then slumbers with her swine, and I can finally steal away, fugitive negro, exit her ex-oinking, ex-squealing mess hall. Thank you. Holy smokes. Time to talk about Caesar. Time to talk about Julius Caesar, because you can't cover the last 2,000 years of those touching on Julius, the man himself, for crying out loud, who Trump would love to be like, would love to aspire to be like Julius. But the only thing that I'd like him to be like Julius is in terms of assassination. But anyway, never mind. That's a joke, Secret Service. That's a joke. It's a joke. I'm a poet. I got no plans. I'm a poet. I'm just joking here. Just joking. And I'm in Canada. I'm not breaking U.S. law. I'm in Canada. The assassination of Julius Caesar by Cinna, the poet. And you'll remember that in Shakespeare's play of the same title, Cinna, there are two Cinnas, the poet, or two Cinna the poets, maybe. One Cinna is mistaken for another. And so Cinna the poet ends up being torn apart by the Roman mob, who've been angered, of course, by Mark Antony, who's turned the mob against Brutus. And Cinna the poet is mistaken for being Cinna the conspirator. But in this poem, it's Cinna the poet. He's still alive. He's writing about the assassination of Julius Caesar. The senators chide him with fasces, the bundled rods, club him so clunkily his bowels expel a mess. Excited by his surprise weakness, senators shellack him, thwack him till all his fecal matter blasts out. He flails, draining like a sewer. Damn, the fascists come down, bitch slap hard. They thrash his pate and crown, crush his eyebrows in. Him, a blush, a gusher. That pretty boy quick got a pummeled face like he be a bum in a boxing ring. The senators stab him in the gut. They jab him in the spine.
They knife him in his red plastered face. Fuck right off. They slaughter him inside out, okay? Well, he bring the stabbings into himself. Fixing the crown on his own regal head was like impaling himself on his sword. Still, the senators are ingrates. They tore the axe off a fascist and struck the blade in his bottom. No joke. His body was a leaking barrel. His blood was turbid liquor. The senators ripped open Caesar's toga to ensure the axe blade could wallow in his backside, even though feces squirted all over. A dismal torture. Damnably asinine stuff. Real diarrhea. Nauseating. Behind the facades of parliaments, assassins party as they plot. And I'm going to end with a short poem. Thank you very much for your patience. This is only the third time for me to read from this book in public, so I really appreciate your attention and so forth. And that's also another way of saying that I'm trying to find the short poem. All right, it's relatively short compared to others in the book. So. This is based on a true story. There are some fictional pieces, but almost everything in this book is based on history. So there was a violinist by the name of George Bridgetower, also known as George Hightower, who was from Austria, but ended up in London. And he was originally the person for whom Beethoven's Kreutzer Sonata was named, or Kreutzer, forgive me for my probable mispronunciation. Ludwig von Beethoven, according to some, was part black. But in the history, which I discovered in the British Museum because of a display they had, or British Library, they had a display a few years ago, George Bridgetower and Ludwig von Beethoven actually had a fist fight over a woman. So that tells me they were both black. Anyway, 1803, London. So this is Bridgetower taking down Beethoven. He says, I hate that Joker's caucasoid negroid face. Hate Beethoven's carping and harping. Hate his exasperating, obfuscating odes. Hate his narrow fiddling with fire violence. Hate his monstrosities, atrocities of tunes. Hate his music that's thatches of cyclones, patches of thunder. I hate most how he hungers to taste my tootsie, zizi, easy kiss and lay, to have her spurn my violin and slouch under mooching him and act impeccably, despicably, licking up and down his milky stick. I hate Beethoven's restless keyboards, his concupiscent keyboards, his counterfeit fluency, unethical etudes that just crucify the nerves. Spikes burst our eardrums, hammers bash our skulls. I tune my violin to espaliered notes, not the black spittle of Beethoven's notes, not that brutish mumbo-jumbo, nor let that toxic licorice creole pester my woman's euphoric triangle with his impish pimp. Braggadocio, his fists incompetent at piano are hardly handy for pugilism. I'll punch out Ludwig's slimy brains. I refuse a trio. I refuse a triangle. I refuse to play second fiddle. Thank you all so very, very much.
Man, just to let you know, he's always that good. He's not just having a lucky day. That brings us to the end of our lunch. Thank you all so much for coming out today. Thank you to all of our authors for their writing, their intelligence, their funny, heartwarming, smart, everything, readings. A big thank you to Sal Mirolla for photographing the event. Sal is here at most of our lunches helping out, and he's a wonderful photographer as well, so we're really lucky to have him. We'll be posting all the photos on our Facebook page and on our website in the next day or two. Thank you as well to our intern, Alex, for all her help today, and not only. Alex has been a big help to us over the past few months, and she's been managing our social media and assisting me with some publicity tasks and things, so she's been great. Thank you, Alex. Thank you to Karen, who is not only a Guernica author, but who makes it out to almost all of our launches to support our authors and to help with introductions. Thank you so much, Karen. Thank you to Shane as well for being our tech help for the day and for making sure that everything goes smoothly with our author videos. And Shane will actually be making some video trailers for a selection of our Spring 2017 titles, so stay tuned for that as well. And finally, thank you to Greg and the whole team at Supermarket for hosting us today. We've been holding most of our launches here, all of our launches, for the past few years, and they're always super welcoming to us, super hospitable. They put up with us every time. So thank you to them.